The basis for this talk is a book that I've written called How to Regulate, which, you know, is selling a million copies because everybody wants to read a book about how to regulate. And the theme of the book is really that, market failure, government failure, and how to sort of minimize the sum of these two types of failure. I think this would be interesting to people from the Show Me Institute because we share a common interest in individual liberty and market-oriented public policies that lead to human flourishing. Before I get into the book, you gotta see the cover because it's beautiful. That's hanging in my living room. I wanna tell you why I wrote it. I have been teaching law at the University of Missouri for the last 15 years. And something that's been very interesting to me in my time at Mizzou is how many of my students have very quickly become top policymakers. I believe the Show Me Institute heard from Justin Smith at some point recently. Justin's a former student of mine. The upcoming Speaker of the House in Missouri, Elijah Haar, is a former student of mine. My students are running these regulatory agencies in the state of Missouri, and I run into them once in a while in bars in Columbia, and they tell me what they're doing, and I get this sort of panic in my heart because I think, how do you know what to do? We never taught you how to regulate. Now, we did teach you administrative law. Administrative law is the law of regulatory agencies, but it's very process focused. It's basically, this is what you need to do to make sure that your rule has the force of law. But we don't talk about the substance of rulemaking. What is it that makes a regulation a good regulation substantively rather than a bad regulation? And that's a problem because lawyers are often the ones that write the rules. Now, economists study that. Public policy, you know, market failures, that sort of thing. But economists have their own blind spots with respect to the law. They, you know, come up with these great textbook models, but then they don't understand what that's going to work how that's going to work when you have to translate that into a rule that's that business planners can use to plan their affairs and adjudicators can use to determine when someone is liable or not. So this book is trying to sort of teach economics to the lawyers and teach some stuff about the limits of law to the economists and other policy wonks that craft rules. So that's why I wrote the book. Now the second thing I should tell you about the book, I should answer a question. Why is a good libertarian, which I purport to be, writing a book that's all about market failures and that seems to encourage regulation? All right, well, let me say at the outset, while the book is about market failures, I think they're extremely rare. I think the market works phenomenally well most of the time. And so there should always be a presumption against interfering in markets. They typically work very well. And the interference usually doesn't work very well. I also should say, I think that people that like me, and I think most of us here, are sort of market-oriented in our thinking on public policy, need to get comfortable talking about market failure. We lose credibility when we don't acknowledge that in certain narrow sets of circumstances, markets fail. And I think if we want to have a place at the table, we need to be comfortable talking about market failures. And we should also continually remind the people that we're talking to that a market failure is never a sufficient condition for a regulatory fix. You always have to ask, can the government actually improve upon this situation? And usually the answer to that question is no, because government intervention is also subject to the same sorts of systematic failures as free markets. So I'll talk about some of those. The biggies that I talk about consistently in the book are Hayek's knowledge problem. We'll talk about what that is, and public choice concerns, the fact that, you know, private interests can manipulate state power for private good at the expense of the public interest. So the essence of my book is a comparison of these two types of failure, market failure, government failure, with some tips to minimizing the total failure. So with that in mind, let's turn to the book. When we're thinking about how to regulate, we should keep in mind the nature of the subject matter. That is, what is regulation's domain? Now, are there any lawyers here? Oh my goodness, okay, there's a few. Of course, I can't go anywhere without seeing a few. So those of you who've been to law school know that in the first year of law school, students learn the common law. Common law, you know, is the body of precedents that were created over the centuries as judges decided discrete disputes between people. The common law is sort of an emergent order, spontaneous order. No one planned it, it evolved. It's highly efficient, it's a wonderful thing. And it's been extremely successful at prohibiting all behavior that we would say is always or almost always bad. So the common law was great at banning stuff that we know that we always want to ban. Torts, intentional torts, fraud, crimes. Common law handled that really well. Regulation sits atop the common law. It picks up where the common law leaves off. And an upshot of that is that regulation's domain, what it's usually looking at, is what I call mixed bag behavior. That is conduct that can be bad in certain circumstances, but it's got some good aspects to it. Right, so you think about the polluting factory, blowing smoke and smells and health risks onto the neighbors. That's bad, these costs that are being foisted onto other people. But that factory creates goods that consumers want. It provides employment opportunities to workers. I mean, there are good things about this too. So we can't just come in and say, we're not gonna let this behavior go on. We'd be sacrificing a lot of good if we said the factory has to shut down. We're dealing with a mixed bag. Now, in light of the mixed bag conduct or nature of regulation's subject matter, regulation will always involve costs. Some costs are absolutely inevitable. So what are those costs? Well, I almost never use PowerPoint. I don't use it in the classroom. I'm very much opposed to it in the classroom. But it was sort of fun to put this PowerPoint presentation together because I just would Google, had an idea. I want a concept, convey a concept. So I Googled the concept and pictures came up. So this is what comes up when you Google, I made a mistake. Right? One cost of regulation is the cost of mistakes. And what I mean here, there's two types of mistakes that involve social costs. One is when the rule goes too far and bans good stuff, false convictions. There are social losses when that occurs. On the other hand, oops, went too far. If the rule doesn't go far enough, it doesn't catch some instances of bad behavior, then we have false acquittals. You take those together, false convictions and false acquittals, and economists would say those are the error costs of any rule. Now, in addition to error costs, rules are always going to involve costs for people who are deciding, can I do this or not, and costs for adjudicators who have to look at what people have done after the fact and say it complied with the rule or it didn't. These are the decision costs, right? So, regulations always involve some combination of error costs and decision costs. Now, this leads to a conundrum for regulators. I did not know until I put this together that there is an actual game called whack-a-mole. I had always heard the term whack-a-mole. I thought it was just a concept, but there is an actual game. It's sort of stupid for me not to know that, I guess. But, you know, in the game of whack-a-mole, which apparently exists, the player will whack down a mole on its head, and a mole will pop up somewhere else. Right? So you're just constantly trying to tamp down a mole in some area. Our three sets of costs there, false conviction, error costs, false acquittal, error costs, and decision costs, are like whack-a-mole. If the regulator tries to tamp down the cost in one area, I don't want any false convictions, so I'm going to have a really lenient rule. Then false acquittal costs rise. If you try to tamp down the false acquittals, I want to get rid of all the bad behavior, then you inadvertently condemn some good stuff, and false conviction error costs rise. If you say, I want to get rid of these error costs altogether, so I'm going to have a more complicated rule that has lots of nuances, exceptions, it's very, you know, it provides for every circumstance and gets the right answer, then the decision costs of the rule go up. It becomes very complicated and unwieldy. A good example of this, anybody know who this is? Wow, a lot of people knew who that was. This is a strange group of people. This is Paul Volcker, who's the former chairman of the Federal Reserve. And Volcker is most famous these days for a rule that he proposed called Volcker Rule, which says that federally insured banks may not engage in proprietary trading of securities for their own profits. This was a rule that had a lot of bipartisan support when the idea was floated. The Wall Street Journal, no fan of financial regulation, had an editorial saying, this is a pretty good idea. Everybody thought it was a good idea. The devil was in the details. Here's the problem. Banks need to be able to engage in hedging transactions. If you've got a borrower who is heavily invested in one area and you think that, you know, they may not be able to pay back their debt if that part of the economy goes south, the bank might need to take a position that's opposite that, right, in order to protect the bank's other clients, et cetera. So banks need to engage in hedging transactions. It's extremely difficult to distinguish a legitimate hedging transaction from risky proprietary trading. So when we sat down to write the rule, we couldn't figure out how to write it in a way that allowed the good without also allowing the bad. And so the drafters opted for nuance. Let's make this more complex. The result of that is that the Volcker Rule ended up being, when written, 1,077 pages long. Right, so you see in that the inexorability of the tension between false conviction costs, false error or false acquittal costs, and decision costs. They're always in tension. All right, what I want to talk about for the rest of my time here, which I don't have a whole lot of, are some tips for addressing this conundrum that the regulators face. And these are they. Here's the first one. This is the picture that you get when you Google, my blanket is too small. We've been in this position before, right, in real life, with actual blankets. You've got a blanket that doesn't cover everything that it needs to cover. So if your chest is covered, your feet are not covered, and vice versa. You can't get everything that you want from this blanket. But there is a way to arrange this blanket to get as much as you possibly can, right? So you can't get perfection in any direction, but you can get optimization. You try to cover as much of you as possible. That's what we ought to be trying to do here. Rather than trying to eliminate error costs or decision costs, the regulator ought to be trying to optimize, that is, minimize the sum of these three sets of costs, false positives, false negatives, and decision costs. You get in trouble when you try to achieve perfection on any of those fronts. Catch all the bad, don't catch any of the good, and keep the rule simple. If you try to be perfect on any of those fronts, you're going to mess up. So the patron saint of policymakers should be this guy. This is the only thing he's useful for, by the way. That's Voltaire. Voltaire had the very famous prudent maxim, the perfect is the enemy of the good. If you aim for perfection on any of these fronts, you're probably going to screw up somewhere. All right, so tip number one is try to minimize the sum of error and decision costs. Now, that's all well and good, but practically, how do you go about doing that? Well, I was thinking when I was writing this book, who do we see in our society that has to make complex decisions quickly, where they're trying to fix a problem without creating a bigger problem? And I thought, you know who does that regularly? Doctors. All right, so tip number two is that the policymaker, the regulator, should think like a doctor. Now, when you go to the doctor, this is what the doctor does. The first thing she does is she assesses your symptom. What is it that's happening with you right now that's undesirable, that you don't like? Now, the doctor doesn't just stop there and say, oh, well, here's something to treat your symptom. You have fever? Here's some fever-reducing medicine. So long. You know, the doctor will ask a second question. What's the disease? What is causing this to happen? All right, so she diagnoses the disease that's causing the adverse symptom. Once she does that, then she catalogs all the potential remedies for that disease. There are usually several things that could be done for any sort of malady. Now, those remedies differ in terms of how difficult they are to implement and also what their side effects are. So she's got to consider the implementation difficulties and the side effects of each of the potential remedies. And then ultimately, she selects the approach that offers the highest net benefit to the patient. This is how I think regulators ought to think. When we see something that we don't like in the world, a situation, don't just address that. Ask sort of what is causing this, right? Why is this happening? Once you've done that, then sit down and think systematically about all the things that could be done to address this underlying disease. And then consider sort of what are the side effects of each of those things. Some policies work well in one context but not in another. There are lots of unintended consequences, et cetera. That's what I have purported to do in this book, How to Regulate. The book is organized after I sort of set up this model of optimization and physician analogy. Then there are six chapters in the book that are organized according to sort of these diseases that are the basis for a lot of regulation. So you've got your four classic market failures: externalities, that is when, a cost creator is not bearing all the cost of his activity; public goods, that is when you've got amenities, goods and services that are both non-excludable and non-rivalrous. Those tend to be underproduced in private markets, although there's a lot of private provision of public goods. I know the Show Me Institute understands that. A lot of people don't, but you do. Market power. Market power exists when you have monopoly or collusion and there's an absence of competition. Information asymmetry, when there's a big discrepancy between the information that one party to a transaction has and the other party. When you've got that situation, you can end up with what economists call adverse selection or a lemons problem. High quality offerings get driven out of the market. That's the basis for our securities regulation. So those are four, the four classic market failures. Then I have a chapter on agency costs. Agency costs are losses that occur when you have a separation of ownership and control. So you've got one party who is managing the property of somebody else. This is what we have in corporations. The corporate managers are managing the property of the shareholders, and we can have all kinds of losses when you've got a situation like that. And then finally, there's a chapter on behavioral economics and this notion that individuals are not rational self-interest maximizers, they're irrational in systematic ways, and that the government ought to do something about that. If you've seen the book Nudge, I'm sort of responding to Nudge in this chapter of my book, and I'm a little pretty skeptical of Nudge. Although the author of Nudge wrote a nice blurb for the back of my book, so I don't want to be too harsh on it. Okay, so a key to this last step, select the approach that offers the highest next benefit, is my next tip. Think incrementally. Now, does anybody, you knew who I guarantee the people who knew who Paul Volcker was will not know what this is. Does anybody know what that is? Spectacular downtown Columbia, Missouri. Everyone should go for a weekend. That is Broadway in Columbia. Columbia is a college town. There are thousands of students and hundreds of drinking establishments. And they're all right there together, and it's dangerous. On a weekend night, Broadway is a dangerous place because you've got a lot of people and a lot of alcohol and too many cars, and it's dangerous. So I asked my students, suppose that your expected loss from jaywalking across Broadway on a weekend night is $20. And what I mean there is the cost that will be incurred if you get hit times the probability that you'll get hit. So, $20 is low, but the chances that you're actually going to get hit are fairly low. If you get hit, it's going to be expensive. But so the expected loss is $20. You could eliminate that loss by walking to this overpass that we have at one end of Broadway, right? It's a great overpass. You just go up some stairs, go across the street, and go down. Now, it's inconveniently located, so it's going to cost you $3 of effort to get down there and cross this overpass. Is it cost justified for you to do that? I ask my students this question and they say, of course it is. You get $20 of benefit for $3 of cost. There's a net benefit of $17. Absolutely, you should do this. The answer though is, well, we don't have enough information to know whether this is cost justified or not. We gotta know what else we might be able to do. So, you don't have to go all the way to the overpass to avoid jaywalking. You could just go to the corner and wait for the light to change and cross with the light. Now, you're not going to eliminate the risk if you do that, because people, when they're drinking and driving, don't always follow the stoplights. And and they don't see you and all that sort of stuff. So there's still some residual risk, but it's not as great. All right, so if you go to the corner and cross, you're going to reduce your loss, your expected loss, from $20 to $1. It doesn't go away all entirely, but you've reduced it quite a bit. Your cost of going to the corner is just $1, not $3. Now, this is actually the better option for you. There's $18 of expected value here. You get $19 in risk reduction at a cost of $1. So there's $18 of expected value instead of $17. This is the better option. And actually, this option is not cost justified when you realize there's something that I could do. It's not as perfect, but it actually gives me higher gain. Right? So this is what we should be thinking about in terms of regulation. When we look at the remedies, the catalog of remedies available for any particular market failure, you can usually put them on a spectrum of restrictiveness. And as you get more and more restrictive with your regulations, the incremental cost of each unit of restrictiveness, marginal cost, tends to rise. And the incremental benefit you get from that extra unit of restrictiveness tends to fall. It's kind of like when you're cleaning out your car. You know, my car's a disaster. My house is meticulous. My car's a disaster. You know, the first steps in that, getting rid of the trash that's in the car, it's not very costly to you, and there's some obvious benefit. Then, you know, you vacuum. It's more costly. The ostensible benefit is not as great as removing the trash. And then, you know, if you're really committed, you'll get out the Q-tip and detail that car. That's very costly, and there's not a lot of incremental benefit. To me, that's totally cost unjustified. So anyway, we want to get to this sort of sweet spot, and that requires thinking of regulatory interventions along the spectrum of restrictiveness and asking for each additional unit of restrictiveness, is it worth it? All right, tip number four. I mentioned that we have some systematic government failures. The two that I emphasize in the book are Hayek's knowledge problem and the public choice concerns identified by James Buchanan and some other economists. So what I'm talking about here in tip number four is the Hayekian knowledge problem. Hayek wrote this fantastic article in 1945 called The Use of Knowledge in Society, where he points out, at a time when socialism was all the rage among the intelligentsia, that central economic planning was destined to fail, because the planners don't have the information that they need to efficiently allocate productive resources. Nobody knows what you need to know in order to allocate the productive resources in an economy at a point where they will, you can wring the most value from them. And he says what we need is a decentralized system where we rely on market prices, and he turned out to be absolutely right on that. Well, if you think about it, most regulation is just a form of central planning. There are some regulators that are saying, this is the outcome that we want, this is how we're going to get there. That requires that they have a lot of knowledge that they don't have. So the regulators should acknowledge their knowledge limitations, and this happens in a couple of dimensions. One is this. You want to acknowledge your knowledge limitations with respect to local facts and circumstances, including people's preferences. So let me give you some examples. These are from financial regulation, because I recently gave a talk on financial regulation, so this is fresh in my head. In the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, which was adopted in the wake of the Enron and WorldCom scandals in, I think, 2002, there's a section called Section 404. That requires public companies to adopt internal controls that are approved by outside auditors. This was an effort to constrain agency costs, and the idea here was that shareholders would benefit if we put these systems in place. Now, that probably does benefit the shareholders of a whole lot of companies. An SEC advisory committee that was looking at the effect of Section 404 found that for companies with greater than $5 billion in revenues, the compliance cost of this rule was just 0.06% of revenues. And it did catch a lot of fraud. So, you know, for those companies, this seems like a sensible thing. But the SEC advisory committee also found that for companies that were smaller, with less than $100 million in revenue, the compliance costs of the rule on a percentage basis were 43 times higher. And so this is a rule that might make sense for some giant companies, but not for smaller companies. The policymakers that are mandating this for everybody don't know whether it makes sense for one corporation versus another. A similar rule from the financial area is the rule that now the stock exchanges have put in place at the behest of the SEC. So we can't, this is not really a private rule. The SEC effectively ordered them to do this. But there's a rule now that says a majority of the directors on a listed company must be outside directors. They can't be employed by the corporation. And the idea, of course, is you want outsiders watching the insiders. Now, that makes a good bit of sense until you think about what it is a board of directors does for a company. And it varies from corporation to corporation. The two primary responsibilities of boards of directors are to monitor the managers and to make substantive business decisions about where the company should go. And boards differ on those fronts. I mean, some boards are really monitoring boards. If you're a monitoring board, then having a majority of outside directors makes quite a bit of sense. But if you're a managerial board, one that's really involved in making business decisions for the company, then having too many outside directors is not a good thing. You need that inside knowledge that you get if you're part of the management team. So this is another one of the sort of one-size-fits-all rules that doesn't account for local knowledge. One thing to note here is that local knowledge also includes people's preferences and this, I just have to tell the story because I love it. Most securities regulation, at least at the federal level, is focused only on ensuring that the companies that are going to sell stock or whatever the security is disclose information. So you can sell as risky a security as you want, but you have to disclose a lot of information. A lot of states have more restrictive securities rules in their blue sky laws. And we call this merits review. They will actually look at the stock or whatever is being sold and ask, how risky is this thing? So they're regulating the merits of the securities. The state of Massachusetts is one of those states. And of course, merits review is more restrictive than mandatory disclosure. So in the state of Massachusetts, when Apple launched its IPO, the securities regulators in that state said, we're not going to let you sell to citizens of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. This is just too risky. Now, who were those regulators to say, to know what my risk preferences are? They made a decision for me, and I lost out on something that was really fantastic. So local knowledge with respect to preferences is extremely important. The flip side of this is that regulators need to have a lot of information about predictions. How is this thing actually going to play out in the real world? Great example of this, again from the financial arena, is the conflict minerals rule. Familiar with this thing? It's absurd. So in Dodd-Frank, there's some language that requires companies that use certain minerals that are produced in war-torn areas of Africa to file all sorts of disclosures. And the idea, this was a name and shame sort of thing. We want you to say, I got my tantalum from some place where there are a lot of warlords. And if you're forced to do that, then maybe you'll get your tantalum elsewhere. Extremely expensive rule because you don't know by the time you get the metal where it came from, but you're responsible for figuring that out and disclosing it. So it's a very costly rule, was put in place. It did have the effect of its intended effect, which was put the minerals business, the mines, out of business in these areas because the mines were being used to finance all these warlords. So that did happen. The mines shut down. Now, when the mines shut down, the villagers who worked at the mines lost their job. The warlords didn't go away. The warlords just turned to a different form of revenue, which is now looting the villages. Right, so there's a great article in the New York Times on this. It's called How Congress Devastated Congo, and it tells the story of this rule. But this was a situation where some hubristic regulator said, we're going to engage in some social engineering here to make Africa a better place. And it backfired because they didn't have the information that they needed to make that sort of a judgment. All right, the second systematic government failure that you always have to keep in mind is sort of these public choice concerns. Public choice is a big, concept, and I don't have time to talk about it in detail, but I want to talk about one aspect of it. Lots of rules create competitive advantages for some group of people and costs that are experienced by a huge number of other people. So concentrated costs and dispersed benefits. And concentrated benefits and dispersed costs. And the costs are often much greater than the benefits, but they're widely diffused and the benefits are concentrated on some small group. So members of that group will lobby to have these rules put in place to benefit them, knowing that the costs are widely dispersed among others and that those people don't have the incentive to come together and lobby against the rule, et cetera. So we get these cost-ineffective rules put in place and they're hard to get rid of because of this concentrated cost-diffused benefits dynamic. Now, it is unseemly for an advantaged group to lobby for a rule that provides it with special benefits. And so what members of these groups will often do is try to find some sort of attractive frontman to go and make the argument for the rule. The classic example of this, and this was pointed out by the economist Bruce Yandel in a fantastic article. The best example of this is bootleggers and Baptists at the time of Prohibition. These were the two groups that were most in favor of Prohibition. Now, bootleggers cannot, with a straight face, go and lobby for prohibition. You know, they can do it in a back room, but they can't do it publicly. So what they needed to do was find some attractive folks. And the Baptists were an attractive group of people. They could go and make the case for prohibition, and we get this rule that was really concentrated benefits and diffuse costs. I guess the Baptists were happy about it, but we Episcopalians were not. The best example of this dynamic comes with occupational licensure. I was really heartened when I was looking at the Show Me Institute website to see that you've been involved in the hair braiding controversy in the state of Missouri. You know, we have a lot of occupational licensure regimes in non-professional occupations that really are put in place to provide a competitive advantage to some group. Now, you can tell some public interest story, oh, we're concerned about damage to people's scalps or whatever, but it's pretty clear what's really going on. A fantastic study by the Institute for Justice recently looked at 102 non-professional licensed occupations and found that only 15 of those 102 occupations were subject to licensure in more than 40 states, and that the average one of these professions was subject to licensure in only 22 states. So in most states, no licensure regime, but in 22, you have to get a license. Well, when you actually look at the quality of the service being provided, it's the same across states. Whether the licensure regime is there or not, it's exactly the same. They also found that there's tremendous variation in the intensity of the licensure regime. So manicurists, there are 10 states that require at least 120 days of training to be a manicurist. Iowa requires 9. Alaska requires 4. You can go to Des Moines or Anchorage and get a perfectly wonderful manicure. Those additional days are just not put in place to provide any kind of public benefit. Instead, this is private interests looking for a competitive advantage. I got some more examples of that, but we'll move on. My last tip here is this one. And this maybe is not, well, I gave this talk to a group of regulators and this is sort of more for them, but there's some good stories attached to this, so I'll make the point to you. We need to always remember that innovation regularly changes the world. Okay, so this comes up, there's several implications of this for regulators. One is this. Innovation can obviate the need for regulation. So, good example of this. You know, we have for a long time, had a restrictive licensure regime for taxi cabs. You have to have a medallion. We've also had restrictions on hotels. You know, you got to comply with all of these rules and get regularly inspected and all of that sort of stuff. And there is an economic rationale for those rules. Now, I think the rules have gone way too far, but you can tell some sort of a story. It would be our information asymmetry lemons problem story. You know, there's a great disparity between the information had by the seller of the service versus the buyer. When you have a situation like that, we can see high quality offerings being driven out of the market because buyers aren't willing to pay because they're scared they're going to get a lemon. So there's a story here that supports these rules. 8 years ago, if you were going to a new city and you learned that there was a convention in the city at the same time, so all the hotel rooms were booked and it was going to be hard to get a taxi, say I had said to you, oh, don't worry about it. Here's what you can do. I'm sure there will be someone driving from the airport to wherever you need to go, and they'd be happy to give you a ride in their car. We'll just have to figure out, you'll have to just find somebody to give you a ride. Won't be hard. Or if you can't get a hotel room, there are plenty of people in this city that have extra bedrooms in their house, and I'm sure that you could pay them to allow you to stay in their bedroom. If I had suggested that to you, you would have looked at me like I was nuts, for good reason. Anybody that's offering to sell you a room in their, a bedroom in their house for the night is crazy. And so you're not willing to pay much for that. And of course, that means that anybody who has a nice room to sell is not going to put it on the market because they can't get enough for it, et cetera. We have our adverse selection problem. And we know what happened. People innovated. Somebody came along and looked at this problem, this lemons problem, and thought, there's money to be made here. And so we end up with Uber, and we end up with Airbnb, and there's technology that addresses this information asymmetry issue, this reciprocal rating system, and that allows, really obviates the need for regulation. So that's one thing to keep in mind. Second thing to keep in mind is that permissionless innovation is key to economic growth. People need to be able to innovate without running to the government and asking for a favor. So I have a section in the book where I take the position that the FCC has now taken on net neutrality. At the time I was writing the book, the rule on net neutrality is that internet service providers were governed by Title II of the Communications Act. Well, the way Title II works is it requires anybody that's engaged in common carriage, communications common carriage, to certify the justice and reasonableness of basically everything that you're doing. You've got to go to the FCC and get permission to do just about anything. Now the FCC, when they put this rule in place, said, we're not going to exercise all of our authority here. We're only going to exercise the vast authority that we have in a limited area. Just, we want no non-discrimination among internet service providers, et cetera. Well, we know the government well enough to know that it has a hard time not exercising authority that's been given to it. What we found when that Title II rule came into place in 2015, in that year, investment by the major internet service providers on capital equipment fell by 12%. That was only the third time in the history of the commercial internet that there was a drop in capital investment in back-to-back years. It happened only two other times. One was in 2001, following the dot-com bust, and the other was in 2009, following the financial crisis. Now, I'm enough of an economist to know that correlation does not equal causation, but this is awfully fishy. And I think probably the reason for this drop in investment was we now have a system where if you want to innovate in any area, you're going to have to run to the government first. Don't invest in that sector of the economy. Last thing here is that regulators will be encouraged to innovate a little bit. And my good story on this is with broadcast licenses. Okay, so with this radio spectrum, we have a public goods issue. We've got a non-excludable, non-rivalrous resource. There is an argument for some sort of a regulatory response to allocating radio spectrum. And what we traditionally did was the FCC would dole out licenses to sectors of the spectrum, and you had to go and make your case for the FCC, and they would hand out permission slips. Well, that system got to be unwieldy. In 1959, Ronald Coase suggested, you know, what we ought to do instead of doing this is just auction off sections of the spectrum. People howled. He appeared before the FCC to talk about this proposal, and the first question the commissioners asked him was this. This is a transcript. Tell us, Professor, is this all a big joke? No one took him at all seriously. But that's ultimately what we ended up doing. In 1994, the FCC auctioned off the first bit of radio spectrum, and following the ideas that Coase had laid out in his article, The Problem of Social Cost, we found that if we just define property rights and we let a market emerge, we're going to get a very efficient allocation of this radio spectrum, and it's just been a giant success. So I think we ought to be encouraging our regulators to innovate. Those are my remarks, and I thank you for your kind attention, and I'm happy to engage. Yes, sir. In theory, we have political accountability, but we know that that doesn't work very well. I think a big problem here is that for many of our regulatory agencies, and I'm just talking at the federal level now, they're designed not to be politically accountable. And so you have these independent agencies that where the president doesn't control the agency. When those agencies make bad decisions, there's nobody to vote out. There are some serious constitutional problems, in my view, with the whole notion of the independent agency. And I'd like to see those gotten rid of entirely. It's a difficult problem. And other than, political accountability and encouraging sound regulation that doesn't vest the regulators with excessive discretion, I don't know what to do. So what I'm trying to encourage is a regulatory scheme that reduces their ability to make these decisions that can turn out so poorly. So try to address the problem up front, because it's really hard. Well, that would be, well, that's a great, yeah, that's a great suggestion. But one of the problems is that a lot of the decisions that regulators make that are so poor are not salient. And so, you have the FDA dragging its feet on approving drugs because the FDA knows if we approve something that's risky and someone dies, we're gonna get really in trouble for it. If we fail to approve something that's effective and 50,000 people die, no one's gonna know. And so, there's a lot of, I would like to look hard at the system and try to figure out how can we come up with mechanisms to make mistakes more salient so that the political system can punish them. But it is a giant problem. Yes, sir. One thing that I think we really need are sunsetting provisions. I think we should have more rules that are, they have a definite end, and we say we're gonna reevaluate this in however many years, and if it's not being enforced, we're gonna take it off the book. Governor Greitens was doing this with his regulatory, I forget exactly what it was called, but they were going through the, experts. Yeah, I can see sort of a super statute at the state level and then also at the federal level that would call for sort of these regular regulatory reviews where we would look and see, are we actually using this rule? Is it doing any good? And ask questions like, has technology obviated the need for this rule? That sort of thing. So my book isn't on revising the system, but that may be the next book. With respect to the second thing on Amazon and Walmart, this is a tough one. And the reason it's tough, I think, is that we have a mixed bag. And here's the mixed bag. These are highly, highly efficient companies, highly efficient. They're a boon to consumers. And our competition law, antitrust, et cetera, is consumer welfare focused. And so it's very hard to establish an antitrust violation when you can't show that consumers are paying higher prices than they otherwise would. And we haven't been able to show that yet. So there are lots of proposals now to revise antitrust to be not entirely focused on consumer welfare. And we're seeing this a lot with the sort of tech monopolies, Facebook and whatnot. But to take into account other considerations. My own view is that's a terrible idea. That was what antitrust looked like until really the 70s. Robert Bork put the kibosh on that. And one of the reasons I think it's troubling is because if we're able to condemn things on antitrust grounds, not on the basis of a harm to consumer welfare, but on the basis of other sort of social harms, we can consider all these other things, then we're really at sea. And the courts and the antitrust enforcers have just a huge amount of discretion to break companies up and to stop business practices that are benefiting consumers, et cetera. And a system like that, I think, would be subject to tremendous public choice concerns that, you know, could be manipulated to achieve competitive advantages for small groups of people at the expense of consumer welfare. So this is one where my own view is I hate to see retail suffer, but until we can show consumer harm from what Amazon and the Walmarts of the world are doing, we just have to live with it. I haven't really, and I would certainly not be in favor of getting rid of limited liability. Limited liability, everybody knows what that is. That basically means that for corporations and LLCs and that sort of thing, when a shareholder invests in the company, they're putting at risk the amount of their investment. They can lose 100% of that. But if the company has claims greater than the value of its assets, the claimant, you know, a contract creditor or a tort claimant, can't come after the personal assets of the shareholders. That's what limited liability means. It's been around forever. And I would not want to get rid of that because it has been an amazing tool for encouraging the facilitation of capital formation, which allows...
But what you're saying is it's extremely valuable.
I'm saying it's extremely valuable, definitely. Yes. Recently, the SEC has tried to do something about this. We have in place now what's called the pay equity rule. People familiar with the pay equity rule? So corporations are required to disclose how the compensation for the median employee compares to the top executives at the company, maybe the CEO. I can't remember exactly who's being compared. But it's another one of those name and shame type of rules that's designed to try to bring down the compensation, you know, to bring them the excessive pay packages for the top folks and maybe raise to some degree what the middle people are paying. It's not working. What it's doing is it's driving companies to outsource. I mean, you're not going to add jobs at the low end because that's going to affect what the median employee earns. And so what it's driving a lot of corporations to do is to outsource their low-end jobs to foreign contractors that are independent contractors, so they don't have to report those folks as their employees. And so here's my basic point. I don't know what to do about the distributive problem, but I'm really scared of making major changes to try to address that because I think there will be some serious unintended consequences. At the end of my book, I say, you know, open questions, and actually both of the two open questions have come up. What this book has not addressed is how do you revise the system to encourage this kind of analysis, and it has also not addressed distributional questions. And I suggest in the last, so maybe you can do this, I suggest perhaps a reader of this book will write a book called How to Redistribute. I don't know how to do that because I can't make the trade-off between sort of efficiency concerns and distributional concerns. That's a philosopher question, and I'm a mere economist. But it's an issue for sure.
Thank you very much. Thank you.